So it's a real special pleasure for me to introduce the speaker. Some of you might have been here a little over 3.5 years ago when she gave the talk here. And so Ori was at that time a candidate for our search associated with an EFRIC theory aligned bridge position. Now you know the history of that. She was offered that position together with Maria Pirulli and both came to Washington University. And since I shared that particular search, I was, of course, particularly happy with that. I'm now even more content that this all worked out very well, because as you have realized, a talk given by a member of the faculty at this time has special significance related to future standing in the department and the university. So let me briefly remind you of her background. She got her PhD in 2010 with Rocco Schiavilla at Old Dominion, a place that is strongly linked to Jefferson Lab. And her work has also been sort of associated with that to some extent, but she branched out, went to Argonne National Lab for a postdoc. She spent time at University of South Carolina, and then went to Los Alamos. And from Los Alamos, she arrived here. In the time that she has been here, she has clearly developed into a major player, further developed into a major player in the field that she is an expert on. Let me just comment that I've never encountered anybody who was asked to write 4 review articles in the same year. Anybody here? No. Of reviews of modern physics, progress in particle nuclear physics, another review of modern physics. These are the top physics reports, so what have you. So she's clearly an expert, in fact, in many different directions. But what I think I'd like to remind you of is that while nuclear physics had an important development period, then went into a sort of stationary mode, it has become even more interesting, apart from its intrinsic interest, because it might well be that in order to establish physics beyond a standard model, you need to very well and accurately describe what happens in nuclei. I think she is one of those people who has realized that and has developed the tools to actually accomplish that, perhaps not immediately right now, but in the future. So with this introduction, let's ask Saori to tell us about fundamental physics with nuclei.
Thank you so much for this introduction. And yes, I gave this talk 3 years ago, so some of the slides are recycled. And I'm here to tell you about the research that we performed here and its connection to nuclear facilities such as Jefferson Lab and the FLIB, but also new experimental facilities that address questions in fundamental symmetries and neutrino physics. And I want to discuss what role nuclear physics plays for these other endeavors in physics. So we start with neutrinos. We know from the standard model they come in three flavors, electron, muon, and tau neutrino. They are chargeless, and according to the standard model, they are massless particles. However, we also know that we observe this phenomenon, which is neutrino oscillation, and essentially means that the neutrino can swap flavor as they travel. And in order to accommodate for these phenomena, we can do that by assigning them a tiny mass. So these masses are called M1, M2, and M3. And then the flavor alien states, so the electron and the muon, are a linear combination of the mass alien state, which are nu1 and nu2. So in this simplified picture, we're only considering two states. So this phenomenon of oscillation can be explained by quantum interference. So you can calculate the probability of switching from a muon to electron neutrino. And generically will depend on neutrino parameters, so mixing angle and masses, but also on the length that was traveled by the neutrino and the initial energy of the neutrino. And this is the key point that I will discuss shortly. There are still unknowns we want to understand. We want to constrain better this parameter. Some parameters are still to be understood. And also it's still to be determined whether this mass eigen state come in this hierarchy, which is called normal hierarchy, or in this inverted hierarchy where M3 is lighter than M1. And so in this figure, you also can see that each mass eigen state has a content from flavor. Red is electron neutrino, green is muon neutrino, and blue is tau neutrino. So there are these unknown, and in order to reveal them, we perform experiments, so to profile and attain neutrino properties. A class of experiment is the accelerator or log-based neutrino experiments. So this is an experimental apparatus here in the States, is this project where neutrinos are produced in Illinois. They travel for about 800 miles and they're detected again in South Dakota. And so here in this little bar diagram, you can see the probability of measuring, for example, the mu neutrino as function of the length traveled by the particle. So neutrinos are produced via decay process. So they do not have a well-defined energy, but they come with a spectrum of energy. So here is the spectrum of the neutrino energy in mu. In the various facilities. And this is a problem because now you need this initial energy to calculate the oscillation probabilities, but you don't know the initial energy. So you need to reconstruct this energy from the final state. And here is a little picture of a final state. This dot here is where the interaction occurred, and these are particles produced in the scattering. This long one being a muon that can travel for about 2 meters. And so now the question is, where is nuclear physics entering? Well, nuclei are the active material of the detectors, and information about, in practice, cross-section of neutrinos with nuclei are required to reconstruct the initial energy of the neutrino that enters these oscillation probabilities. And so really, knowledge of the energy relies heavily on how accurate we do know the cross-section for neutrino nucleus interactions. So in order to make a point of this, this is a figure that shows the neutrino cross-section that is scattering from carbon-12. The magenta dots are the experimental data. And all these lines are theoretical models where nuclear many-body effects are not considered fully. And so you can see that you can well underpredict the data in the cross-section. And so that would impact on the accuracy on your extracted initial energy of the neutrinos, okay? So this is one program where nuclear physics is relevant. There are other experimental efforts in neutrino stable beta decay where nuclear physics play an important role. So let's look at standard decays. So single beta decay is a process where a neutron inside the nucleus decays into the proton with the emission of an electron and an antineutrino. In practice, what's happening here is that here you can see the binding energy of these systems. And what's going on in a decay is that a nucleus decays into another one that is energetically more convenient. And so because you are transforming a neutron into a proton, here you have the number of protons on the x-axis. So you are increasing Z by one unit. So this is beta decay. And in this decay, you are conserving the charge. So you are producing a unit of charge. So you have one more proton. So to balance that, you're also producing an electron. There is another thing that we conserve, which is called the lepton number. And for this talk, we can think of the lepton number as being a matter number. So you are producing a unit of matter, and therefore to balance that, you produce an antineutrino, which is a unit of antimatter, okay? So this is a standard process. We use beta decay to really validate our model. There are several data very accurate. So this is a place where we can really test the validity of our model. In this chart, you can see that here, in this case, it's not convenient for these nucleus to undergo single beta decay because the energy is larger. But it is convenient to jump by two units in the charge and undergo what is called a double beta decay. So twice this process. This double beta decay was first imagined by Maria Goppermeier. And also here, everything is fine. So you have two units of matter and two units of antimatter. So everything is, so to speak, standard. But there is another way you can possibly go from here to here, and that is neutrino-less double beta decay. Sorry. So in other words, here is the process. It's just like before. You produce two electrons, but you do not produce two antineutrinos. So you're violating the mass number. This can happen via, for example, this is one of the many possibilities where you have two neutrons that decay into two protons with the emission of two electrons alone. And now you have that the neutrino, for example, it's its own antiparticle. So that's called the Majorana neutrino. And it gets exchanged between the two nucleons. So this decay has not been observed, but if it is observed, then it will have important implication of theoretical implication. One place where it could impact is the observed asymmetry between the matter and the antimatter. So here is a little rendition of the asymmetry. So something was wrong at a certain point, and that made it possible that we are here. So a very important, lots of experimental effort are in this in searching for this decay. Again, where is nuclear physics entering here? So if you do observe that decay rate, so this would be the number that you get from the experiment. This is what you're after, which are the effective masses of the neutrino. In practice, are the neutrino parameters. If you want to access this knowledge on the effective masses, you must have knowledge on the nuclear matrix element. And this can only be obtained from theoretical calculation. So this is where nuclear physics plays a role. So you need to have them from the field. And another thing, of course, is that from the nuclear matrix element, you can have an estimate of how much material do you need to observe few decays, few events per year. So that's another reason why you need this input. So how much material you need to buy to see few events per year. So this to give a sense of where nuclear physics plays a role. And now let's try to see what kind of energy and momentum are involved. So here is an increasing values of energy and momentum released to the nucleus. So omega is the energy and Q is the momentum released to the system. And so you see that different experiments are located in a different position in this kinematic chart. And that means that you have to acquire knowledge and understanding of nuclei in different kinematic regions. So that adds a layer of complication. So another way to see it is to look at this cartoon picture of the cross-section of electrons scattering from nuclei. Here it's a fixed values of momentum transfer and an increasing value of energy transfer to the nucleus. And so depending on how much energy we put into the nucleus, we can observe ground state properties at zero energy. If we increase the energy, we access low-lying nuclear state and the collective excitation. And this is called the quasi-elastic region, where you can approximate a nucleus as a collection of uncorrelated nucleons. And comparatively, this region is simpler than this low-energy region, where a lot of clusterization inside the nucleus is observed. But at any rate, all of these experiments test and probe different regions in these nuclei. And so I will, so this, what is their strategy to have access to this fundamental observable or precision test of the standard model? So the strategy is to look at data, available data, where you can validate your nuclear model in increasing in the selected kinematic region. So at low energy, you can look at form factor, electromagnetic moments, then you increase the energy, and you can start seeing electromagnetic decay or electron scattering. And once you validate your model against available data, you can make prediction or make assessment for more exotic observable. And so today I will tell you about the studies that we performed in this group of observable and discuss selected the conclusion that we can attain for this other group. All right, so we need to study nuclei, and this is a rendition of a nucleus. The ultimate degrees of freedom are quarks and gluon. We have a theory that describes the dynamics of quarks and gluon, and that's quantum chromodynamics. But the actual degrees of freedom on nuclear physics are bound the states of quantum chromodynamics, so protons, neutrons, and pions. So one layer of difficulties inside this system is how do we construct interactions among nucleons that preserve the symmetries exhibited by the underlying theory. So in principle, we could just say, okay, let's use a QCD to construct the nuclei. That's very, very expensive. Only like about 5 years ago, some calculation of magnetic moments for Triton came out that were done from lattice QCD calculation. So we need to, that approach will not allow us to reach to larger nuclear system. So we need to build interactions that are effective. So our preferred theory to construct this interaction are effective field theory. These are low energy approximation of QCD, but preserve all the symmetry exhibited by the underlying theory. So this would be the theoretical tool that we're gonna use to construct the interaction among the nucleons. So that's one layer of complication. And the second one, of course, is that now you have a many body problem of strongly interacting particle, and you need to solve for the many body dynamics of this system. So these are the two main endeavors in studying nuclei. Okay, so what is the general idea of the theoretical approach? It's called the microscopic or ab initio approach. It's based on the idea that is deceptively simple, that we can describe all nuclear properties in terms of interactions of nucleons in pairs and triplets, an interaction of electrons, neutrino with nucleons, and correlated cluster of nucleons inside the nucleus. So these are called respectively forces, so or correlation that connects nucleons in pairs and triplets. Instead, when we add an external probe, we talk about currents. And of course, we need to solve the many body problem. To solve the Schrödinger equation, which implicitly means that we are working in a non-relativistic regime for this to solve this problem. Okay, so now we have all that I said in words is written here in this many body nuclear Hamiltonian. You have the sum of the kinetic energies. The nucleons are correlated in pairs via two body force, and in triplets via three body force. There are several degrees of freedom, not only the position of all the particles, but also the spin and the isospin of all the particles. So the problem becomes increasingly expensive with the number of nucleons, and that requires the utilization of high performance computing. And okay, so now we have a theory. I'm not going to discuss in detail the effective field theory, but I told you it's a low energy approximation of the underlying theory, QCD. And ultimately, it allows you to work with nucleons. So this line here represents nucleons. And the interactions between nucleons is described in terms of the exchange of pions. So this idea goes back to, it really goes back to Yukawa, the Yukawa potential, which is short range compared to the Coulomb potential. And in addition to this contribution, we also have to include very short range terms. And depending on the formulation, but in general, they will have a strength that is given by unknown parameters. These are called low energy constants. And these unknown parameters, depending on the model, you have order of 20 or 30 parameters. You need to feed them to a large database of NN scattering data. A large database means like order of 1,000 points to constrain this nuclear-nuclear interaction. Of course, in principle, we could obtain these constants from lattice QCD, but again, we are still far from attaining them from QCD, lattice QCD population. These are the interaction of our choice. Argon-AB18, it's a two-body interaction, and Urbana-9 and Illinois-7 are three-body interactions. And as of recently, we are extensively using the interaction developed by Maria, which are chiral effective PTR interactions, and are also called the Northcott model. Okay, just to have a sense, as I said, how does it look like the two-body interaction? We call it long-range interaction, is driven by a one-pion exchange. This intermediate region is driven by a two-pion exchange, and then you have a repulsive core. As I said, this is different from what we are used in atomic physics, and give rise to this kind of system. This is the lightest nucleus you can possibly construct, is the deuteron. It has spin one, so you can place it in electromagnetic field, so you can polarize it. And you can get this kind of density distribution. So here the holes is related to the repulsive core of the nuclear-nuclear interaction. Okay, so now that's not the end of the story. The interaction, there is a lot of development, in fact, done by Jason and Maria on optimizing further the two-body interaction. So here are the low energy constant. This is a corner plot. And utilizing Bayesian method, you can also get an estimate of the posterior distribution for these parameters that enter the nuclear-nuclear interaction. So that is really an improvement, and it allows you to establish an error estimate for your theoretical calculation. All right, so we made the deuteron, so but now we want to make a larger nuclear system. And so briefly, what are the quantum Monte Carlo methods? So your goal is to calculate matrix element for many body system, and you can proceed in two steps to construct the nuclear wave function. You can utilize a variational principle. So you construct what we call the trial wave function or a variational wave function. This object has parameters inside, and they are minimized. Well, they are obtained by minimizing the energy expectation value. So this is a standard procedure. But now your variational wave function has contamination, as we know, and it's very good for energy, perhaps, but you need to improve it for other observables. So to improve and get rid of the contamination in the trial wave function, we perform an evolution in time, in imaginary time. So the idea here is to write down the variational wave function as a sum of eigenstate of the nuclear Hamiltonian. And so if you propagate in imaginary time, you see that this exponent, if you wait long enough, is gonna kill all the components, but the component corresponding to the states you're trying to construct. In this case, in this example, the ground state. And so here is just an example of propagation. So you start off here with an energy calculated with the variational wave function, which then is get improved. And cleaned off all the contaminated states by propagating in imaginary time. All right, so this technique has been used to study the energy of nuclei. So this is again a quantum Monte Carlo calculation of the spectrum of light nuclei obtained with two different nuclear models. The red one are the one, the Northcott interaction from chiral effective theory. And again, there is a very nice agreement with the experiment, which is given in green. But more importantly, these kind of plots are a validation of the microscopic picture. So you're starting with the two and three body forces. So you correlate the system with two and three nucleon forces, and then you can reproduce the properties of light nuclei. Okay, so this is for the strong sector, so to speak. But now what we're interested in is to describe the interaction of this system with the external probe. So here L can be an electron, a neutrino, even dark matter. And the way we proceed is, again, including contribution from interaction of the probe with one nucleon at a time. But we also account for corrections due to the fact that, in fact, the nucleons are correlated in pairs. And so because the nucleon are interacting among each other, you get an additional correction, which is called two-body cavents. So you can have a two-body charge or two-body vector cavent. Okay. So we have correlation inside the nucleus, and external probe are interacting with pairs of correlating nucleons. So we retain all of this information when we perform the calculation. And it turns out that if you live in the single particle paradigm, so if you only utilize the one body operator, you are off and unable to explain the experimental data. So you really need to account for many body effects. So how do these operators look like? This is just to give a sense. So we saw that the nucleon-nucleon interaction is carried, mediated by the exchange of a pion. So now you have an external probe, for example, a photon, and is interacting with the pions being exchanged between two nucleons. So that's how you can visualize it. And you have, of course, one pion exchange, but we saw that also we had two pion exchange contributions. So you have also this kind of terms and also contact light terms. Okay, so we have the currents and we have the wave function. So we can calculate electromagnetic observables. And here is where we really test our model. There is plenty of data, and most of the time they're known with the great accuracy. And here are just three examples in increasing value of energy transfer. So the first figure shows magnetic moments. This is a ground state property of nuclei. And the black star represent the experimental data. Black stars here and black stars here represent experimental data. The theoretical calculation in the single particle paradigm are given in blue, and you see that they reproduce the bulk properties of nuclei. But if you want to reach agreement with the experiment, now you have to include the two-body correction, and the full calculation is given in red. So this correction cannot be neglected because they can be as large as a 40% in selected observables. Here we're increasing energy. So this is the matrix element for electromagnetic decay. And as before, the black stars are the experiment, and you can appreciate the agreement with the experiment of the full theory by comparing the red calculation with the black. So one here is because we are normalizing with experimental datum. And likewise, these are cross-section for electron scattering from the alpha particle compared with the experiment. Okay, so what are we focusing now that we have established the electromagnetic properties of nuclei is neutrino interactions with nuclei. And here the situation is a little bit more complex. And I'm showing an observable at low energy. So these are beta decay and an observable high energy. I showed this to you before. This is the cross section of neutrinos from carbon 12. And if you look here, this is a correlation plot where you have the theoretical calculation of the rate for gamma teller, so from beta decay. And on the y-axis, you have the experimental datum. And all these dots are nuclei. And so if the theory were to be in agreement with the experiment, you would expect that all the dots would line up in the magenta line. But instead here, you can clearly see that the theory is systematically overpredicting the experimental datum. the theory with the simplified wave function, I must add, so where many body effects are not fully included. On the other hand, if we go to high energy, the theory is systematically underpredicting the data. So one thing that we are addressing is how to reconcile these two behavior at different energies. So I'll start off with showing you some calculation of beta decay, and I will compare with the calculation reported in this green line, where everything is overpredicting the data. So those calculations in green will be given by this square green symbol. And one is the experimental datum. And again, our full calculation is represented by these magenta stars. And so just the act of including many body effects quenches the matrix element and brings it to a great, a good agreement with the data. So this is yet another example where many body effects are required to reach agreement with the data. So this kind of decays have been recently analyzed in full detail by Garrett using the Norfolk interaction. I won't go into details, but qualitatively the results are analog to the one that I just showed you. But a very nice study has been performed about the distribution of these two body operators. This is a little bit technical, but it's very important because it gives us knowledge of the role of this kind of short, very short range contribution to these matrix elements. So as I said, it's a little bit technical, but let me say that these lines represent transition density, meaning that if we take the integral over the interparticle distance, we recover the matrix element. And this study shows an analysis between the two different interactions and clearly show a difference in the behavior of the short range contribution, which is this green, green kind of currents. So this is actually relevant because there are lots of studies addressing how to constrain these interactions. Okay, so let me move to beta decays where we validate our model. And let's move on to neutrinoless double beta decay. So we said that we are after calculating this matrix element that enters the half-life in order to be able to extract the neutrino parameters. So what is this plot showing? It shows the current situation of calculated matrix element for nuclei of experimental interest. So these are all the nuclei that can undergo a neutrinoless double beta decay. And these are all theoretical calculations performed to calculate this matrix element. And you see there is a rather wide spread. So this matrix element are off by a factor of two or three. That's reasonable because as we go farther and we have more nucleons, your computational methods becomes way more approximated. So you're forced to leave out some physics. But definitely this is something that needs to be addressed because if this is the situation, then we will not be able to attain information on the neutrino masses. So what can we do? So in practice, what I'm trying to say is that we need to improve the knowledge of this matrix element, which at the moment have a large spread. And so what can we do? We can study light nuclei. Exactly. We are able to explain a lot of properties that are in nice agreement with the data. So the idea is to use light nuclei to study these neutrinoless double beta decay matrix elements. So here is an example of a calculation of these matrix elements. And you can see that these are systems that are not relevant for the experimental program. But we can determine the relevance of the various mechanisms that lead to neutrinoless double beta decay. Okay, so we study light nuclei Exactly, to inform theoreticians that can study larger system of what are the most important contribution to these processes. From this initial study, which have been now performed by many groups, we attained information that in neutrinoless double beta decay, the momentum carried by the neutrino is of the order of 200 MeV. So that's an information that we're going to utilize later. So what I'm trying to say is that we study this object in light nuclei, exactly, and we can benchmark with the theoretical models that can calculate larger nuclear systems. And so this is a study of the kind. So our calculations are in blue and yellow. So this is the calculation. And all of these calculations are obtained in a shell model. A shell model can be used to study nuclei of experimental interest for neutrinoless double beta decay. And the ab initio calculation is used as if it was experimental data. So at the end, you can pick the model that is closer to the ab initio calculation. So this is, again, another important information for the program. So I want to use this piece of information right here, which is that the neutrino carry a momentum of the order of 200 of MeV. And justify the study of muon captures. Again, muon captures are processes that occur a momentum transfer of the order of 100 MeV, and there is data. So this is a place where we can verify whether our model is also valid in this kinematical regime. And so here are, in this figure, here is the experimental datum to be compared with the theoretical calculation that we performed given by this blue star. So there is a nice agreement in this particular transition. As I said, we are interested in validating the model at this value of momentum transfer. And we are also studying other systems. These are our values, and the experimental error here is very large. So it would be interesting if this kind of processes could be remeasured, given that the data are quite old. And essentially, studies on muon capture will really help to validate both the current and the nuclear Hamiltonian in this kinematic regime relevant for neutrinoless double beta decay. Okay, so I covered ground state properties and beta decays, and this new observable, which is occurring at this kinematic regime. So the last overview is on our contribution to the Jefferson Lab and the Dune experimental programs. And here, as we know, we need to provide cross sections. And as of recently, we developed a new algorithm, which is called the short time approximation, which allows you to calculate these processes of scattering from the nucleus in an approximated way, where you only retain two-body physics information. By that, I mean that the external probe is scattering from pairs of correlated nucleons. So it's based on factorization, and you only keep as active systems in the scattering problem pairs of correlated nucleons. So this is a new algorithm, has been just developed. And it allows you to write, in addition to cross sections, which is what you compare with the experimental data, it allows you to write something that we call the response densities. And this object gives you a snapshot of the nucleus soon after it interacted with the external probe. Actually, soon after it interacted with a pair of correlated nucleons inside the nucleus. So, it's an object that depends on the relative momentum of the pair and the center of mass momentum of the pair. So this density looks like this. So you have a dependence on the relative energy of the pair and the center of mass energy of the pair. And this is the scattering of electrons from the alpha particle. This object gives you way more information, inelastic information about the process. You can, for example, slice up this, this 3D plot and pick a selected kinematic for the center of mass of the pair that is being struck by the probe, and attain information at the kinematic about the content of the response. So you can look at how much of the scattering comes from proton-proton pairs, neutron-neutron pairs for the full response. So very briefly, we did utilize the scheme to study alpha particle, but recently also helium-3 and Triton. So these are recent results obtained by Lorenzo. And there is a lot of development and work in progress to make this algorithm feasible and making it more efficient so that larger nuclear systems can be accessed. So this is, again, work that is ongoing. And the preliminary results for carbon-12 just came out for the responses and the cross-section of carbon-12. Okay, so I gave you an overview of the research that we are carrying out. We are constructing fundamental and basic interactions among nucleons and looking at electroweak observables in a very wide range of energy and momentum transfer. So from beta decays, muon capture and the scattering of electrons and neutrinos. And we are living in a time where collaboration between different area in nuclear physics, high energy and the lattice QCD are required different expertise to make progress. And for the future, I was told to have one slide on how does this fit on the generical program in nuclear physics. So just as an highlight, the questions that are addressed are essentially met by the outlook in our program. So study of electroweak properties, further development of factorization scheme and studies of the effect of many body correlation and how they impact on fundamental symmetries and neutrino physics. And so this is it. And thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you. Comments, questions?
So how much tighter are the bounds on the two double beta decay or going to have to be, or what level would a positive detection have to be in order to significantly constrain these theories to tell us not just that there's a number, but that had, in some really meaningful way, there really are Majorana particles?
Oh, yeah, well, I don't know that if I may keep to answer the question. So I was, I can tell you about the accuracy that is required for the matrix elements. That is a request. So the usual request for us is to attain an accuracy at the 10% level on those system.
Where do the, so if I were to try to plot the experimental bounds, never been,
oh yes, I don't have the figure. Yes, I don't have the figure. So there is the figure which, yeah, I don't have it, but I can definitely show it to you. But essentially the main uncertainty comes from nuclear matrix element in order to fix the neutrino parameter. So there is the usual plot and the main uncertainty comes from the matrix element of nuclei.
Let's put it say in terms of calendar, can I expect this field to change in the next 10 years? So that of course depends on how experimental technology develops. You know, are we going to, it's thinking something completely unrelated, gravity waves. There was a prediction that gravity waves would be seen once LIGO, we got advanced LIGO, and LIGO, advanced LIGO told us really these sources are out there and here are how many of them and a lot of details. you know, so when, you know, what are we going to know more about whether, you know, whether neutrinos actually are Majorana particles or not?
Yes, so, I mean, my answer to that is that for us, nuclear physicists, this program has been really a drive. I entered this program like 3 years ago, and 3 years ago there's been a collaboration, the topical collaboration that was addressing this issue. And from the nuclear standpoint of view, it brought a lot of development. So regardless of the impact on the Majorana nature of the particle, from the nuclear standpoint of view, we had a great development in terms of accessing larger nuclear system or making a new algorithm to be able to get to this kind of system. And everything was really driven by this program from the nuclear standpoint of view. So for us, it's been good. But I'm not, as I said, I'm not equipped to address your question. Perhaps is Bhupal here? No. Okay.
We definitely want this
limits
to shrink.
Yes.
And your effort is going to help with that.
That's it. It's now it's a factor of 2 and 3. So there is a lot. There is a lot of development and improvement.
Yeah. Jim raised his hand.
Oh, how do I do this? Sorry.
You
just start talking.
I always wonder with the effective field theory, the idea is, you know, that, you know, you can't do the full lattice QCD. So you say it kind of looks like you have exchange of pions and maybe you have to include 2 or 3 body interactions. And ultimately the test is comparison with experiment. But why should I think it'll work to exchange pions, or why do I not exchange lambdas, or why do I not exchange? I don't know.
So basically, in this little plot, in fact, I rush over and you have rho, omega, sigma, whatever, you can exchange.
Oh, okay.
So you can, you know, depending on, because the range of this interaction depends on the mass of the meson you're exchanging, depending on the mass that you're exchanging, you can make it heavier or lighter as you wish. The reason why you're using pion in chiral effective field theory is because they are, coming from the chirality of the interaction. So everything is written in terms of pion exchange. And the way you make it shorter range is that you keep adding pions. And so the range becomes 1 over 2m, 1 over 3m, and so on. But in principle, yeah, you can exchange. So all the models, like the famous interaction is called the CD bond potential, had also this kind of contribution.
Is it because it's just a matter of energetics of the mass of the different mesons, or is it also like because of
symmetries?
A pi knot is a pi knot is special in various ways, right?
Yes, so they also have like pseudoscalar coupling,
right.
So there is a lot of symmetries going there as well.
I see. So I just, it always seems kind of like magic to me that it works, but I just don't ever know how one decided they could get away with that. I mean, I know Yukawa kind of thought a pi exchange was a good model in the early days, but yeah, it always seems kind of magical.
Also, the theory, right? I mean, it emerges like that when you break chiral symmetry. So theoretically, that's where it comes from.
There are people who think Steven Weinberg's contribution to physics was more important in the context of developing and emphasizing effective neutrinos than what he for the standard model.
Yeah, there must be some very intricate, complicated arguments of why it works, but it's interesting though. Thank you.
A naive question. What does it mean that neutrinos is an antiparticle?
It's chargeless, so you can really just make it, you can have like no distinction between the nu bar and nu. So it's the same particle.
They can annihilate with each other when
they are the same particle. So you don't have distinction between the neutrino and the neutrino. It totally works still when you solve the Dirac equation. It's a possibility.
Then you only have one field to describe them.
Yes. This is a question.
Other comments, questions?
So one of the great successes that your great success at low energy was getting the magnetic moment of carbon 9, the 3/2 minus ground state. How do you get the 1/2 minus excited state in the right place, the spin orbit splitting correct or better when you take into account the two body? So you showed us the great improvement. I mean, you showed us a lot of cases, but the one, the carbon 9 lower right-hand corner there is a spectacular improvement. So, but that's the magnetic moment for the ground state. But yes. Then there's the 1/2 minus excited state, I recall was not reproduced very well in energy.
I haven't looked at that, but I didn't know even that it was not reproducing in the single particle picture.
Yes.
Okay, good.
It should do better now.
But so that's the question. Do you solve that problem too?
No.
No, or you don't know?
No, I don't know.
Yeah, okay.
So I never tried it.
You might have solved that problem too.
No, I mean, this is, yeah.
There's a question in the chat from BJ.
Okay.
I can read it. How do you justify a belief in the results for low A nuclei that are far away from the relevant large A nuclei?
Yes, that's a good question. So for large nuclei, the thing that we can think of that could be different is, for example, in the Hamiltonian, for now, we are neglecting forces beyond the three body force. This is fine to be suppressed with respect to two body force. But in larger nuclear system at high density, there could be that you can have more contribution from a higher component in this main body expansion. So yes, I take that point.
I was a bit curious, the transparency that you showed before with the experimental data. They match very well, except there are this. So why is the boronate and the lithiumate, they seem to be a bit off. Is there an explanation for that?
Yes. So these are, these are the A equal to H systems. Quite frankly, we have a lot of, so we don't do well with this A equal to H system. So here in this case, you cannot really tell because the experimental error bar is really large. But in general, you are a little bit off here, but what is worse is that we're really, really off here. And we do understand that we need to improve the wave function in this system. So we're missing information in the wave function, and it's consistently seen in pretty much everything we do with 8. Well, here there is no beryllium, but in general, they have a very rich structure, and we are not able to grasp it all.
Some symmetry reason, and why it happens at 8?
I know the beryllium 8, we have difficulties because there are a lot of resonances, and so we're not able to describe those. But yes, no, I don't have a clear crisp answer to that.
So later on, when you describe this, you call it the short time approximation. You showed a plot where the model reproduces the data well on one, this one. Yeah, so you show that the model reproduces well the data in one regime, but not in the in the high momentum. Is that expected because of the way?
Yes. Because in all that I discussed, unfortunately, we don't have other degrees of freedom than protons and neutrons. So we don't have pions, for example. We only have virtual pions, so they are exchanged, but we don't have a real pion that is scattered. And so this little peak here is pion production. So when you, we cannot have it because we didn't include it at all in the theory. So that's another the thing that we want to do, and another reason for which we developed this short-term approximation, because with this factorization we can also include this kind of mechanism when you produce some particle at the end.
Okay, I think people have had an opportunity to ask questions, and if you are like me, it's always nice if the speaker keeps herself or himself to the time so that before 5 o'clock we can finish this get together and say we have enjoyed a very good talk. Thank you very much.